MenapU presents Completing the Square.
What's this all about?
Hey folks, today we're going to cover completing the square, which is a method for solving quadratic equations and converting quadratics into forms that allow us to graph shapes such as circles and parabolas. To begin, let's talk about how we would normally solve for a variable in algebra. Take this equation right here, for example, 5x squared plus 4 equals x squared plus 20. Normally what we're going to do is combine like terms and then isolate for x. So in this case, we're going to get 4x squared on the left equals 16. We're going to divide both sides by 4. And then we're going to take the square root. Now remember, when we take a square root, we want to include the positive and the negative possibilities. Now let's talk about a scenario when just solving for x won't work. So for example, x squared equals 4x. We might be tempted to divide both sides by x and get x equals 4. But we've actually lost one of the solutions there. If x happened to be equal to 0, that equation is also going to work. So this is not technically the right way to solve this equation. Instead, what we're going to do is take advantage of the zero property. And just as a review, the zero property says that if you have, let's say, an a times a b, and that equals zero, then we can conclude that either a, b, or both of those unknowns has to also equal zero. So in the case below, we're going to set our equation equal to zero and then factor it to find both of our solutions. Here we'll write x squared minus 4x equals 0. And then we're going to factor out that x and get x times x minus 4 is equal to 0. That means that x, in this case, would have to be equal to 0 for the equation to go to 0, or equal to 4. And here's another example on the right. This time we have a constant term, and you can see to begin with that if we were to divide through by x, we would get x minus 12 over x equals 4. And we're going to be no better off trying to solve that for either x or x squared than if we hadn't even divided through in the beginning. So that would not be a good way to attempt this problem. Instead, we're going to do what we did before. We're going to set the whole equation equal to 0. So we're going to subtract over that 4x and get x squared minus 4x minus 12 is equal to 0. And we'll do the sort of the guess and check method of factoring here. We're going to look for two factors of 12 that would give us 4 if they were subtracted. And we know that 6 times 2 is 12. So we could factor this as x minus 6 times x plus 2 equals 0. And that tells us that x would either have to be 6 or negative 2. But what about a scenario where factoring just doesn't seem like an option? Here we have x squared minus 4x minus 7 equals 0. If we look at 7, we're going to see its only factors are 7 and 1, because 7's prime. And we can't combine 7 and 1 either through addition or subtraction to get negative 4x. So in this case, we're not going to be able to factor like we normally would. What could we do instead? We could use the quadratic equation, which will be a video for another day. But what if we could turn the left side of our equation here into a perfect square and then take the square root of both sides like we did in some of the previous problems? Before we attempt that method, let's just review what a perfect square looks like when we have a binomial of one term minus another. So here we have x minus b squared, which is the same as x minus b times x minus b. And we're going to FOIL, and we're going to see that we'll have our first term is going to be x times x, so we'll get an x squared. Then we're going to do x times negative b, which would give us a negative bx. Then we're going to do that again, and we're going to get negative b times x. And then finally, we're going to do negative b times negative b. So we're going to get plus b squared. And cleaning that up, we get x squared minus 2bx plus b squared. And a couple interesting things to note here. Our final constant term is just b squared. It's whatever our term was in our binomial before, the constant term squared. And our middle term, its coefficient is 2b. It's two of those b's that we originally had. Let's see how we can use that to complete the square. Okay, now we're going to see how we can use completing the square to solve a quadratic equation. Just a reminder from the previous slide, x minus b squared is equal to x squared minus 2bx plus b squared. That means in this case, our equation on the left, which is that quadratic from before that we could not factor, in that case, our middle term, our negative 2bx, is going to be equal to the negative 4x. That means our 2b is 4 in this case. And if we divide 2b by 2, we get 2. And if we square the result, we get 4. That tells us if we could isolate the x squared minus 4x in the original equation and add in 4 to it, we would have a complete square that we could solve just by taking a square root. Let's go ahead and do that now. So we're going to start by bringing over the 7 to the right side of the equation through addition. And now we're going to add in that 4 to complete our perfect square. So x squared minus 4x plus 4. And remember, whatever you do to one side of the equation, you have to do to the other. So we're going to add 4 to the right as well. This is now a perfect square. X squared minus 4x plus 4 is a perfect square. We're going to factor it. X minus 2. So notice our b term is always going to be right here. And on the right side, we're going to have 11. Now we can just go ahead and take the square root of both sides. X minus 2 would be the square root of x minus 2 squared. Remember, we need to account for the positive and negative possibilities. So we're going to get plus or minus 11, square root of 11. And now we're just going to solve for x by adding 2 to both sides. So we're going to get x is equal to 2 plus or minus square root 11. And those of you familiar with the quadratic formula, you'll often see an answer produced in this form where you have an integer and a radical with it. All right, let's run through another example. This time, however, we're going to have a leading term. We're going to have a leading coefficient, a negative 3. And the procedure is pretty much going to be the same, except this time we're going to start by dividing through by that negative 3. So that's going to give us a x squared. Negative 18 divided by 3 is going to be positive 6. And negative 9 divided by negative 3 is going to be positive 3. Once we've cleaned up the equation by dividing through by negative 3, let's go ahead and isolate the constant term again. So we'll get x squared plus 6x equals negative 3. And going back to that pattern before, our 2b middle term, coefficient of our middle term, is 6 this time. So that tells us that, all right, 2b is 6. B would be equal to 3. And b squared would be equal to 9. So what we want to do is we want to add a 9 to both sides of the equation. We'll get x squared plus 6x plus 9 equals negative 3 plus 9. That has now completed the perfect square on the left. We can factor that as x plus 3. And that term for our perfect square, the constant term right here, that's always going to be b is equal to 6. And we'll solve like we traditionally do. We're going to take the square root of both sides. So then we're going to get x plus 3 is equal to plus or minus the square root of 6. And isolating for x, we'll get negative 3 plus or minus square root of 6. All right, so let's just review the general steps for completing the square. Step number 1, divide the leading coefficient if necessary. So that's what we did in the last example. If your leading coefficient is 1, you're not going to need to do that step. Step number 2, isolate the constant term. So every time we've brought that constant term over to the right before we've added in our b squared. Step number 3, divide the coefficient of the middle term by 2. So we saw that our middle term is 2b. We take whatever that coefficient is, we divide it by 2 to get b. Square the result, that gives us our b squared, and add it to both sides of the equation. Step number 4, take the square root of both sides of the equation and simplify any radicals. Remember, actually, before that step, we want to take that perfect square and factor it. We want to turn it into an x plus b squared before we actually take the square root. And then step number 5, isolate for the x term, essentially finding your solution. Okay, so let's go ahead and do a practice problem. Go ahead and pause the video here now if you'd like and give it a shot. I'm going to forge ahead. So in this case, we do have a leading term. We have a 5. And I'm going to begin by dividing through by 5. So our first term is going to become x squared. Then we're going to have plus 10x, because 50 divided by 5 is 10. And then our constant term is going to be 30. 5 times 30 is 150. And 0 divided by 5 is still 0. All right, so now, reviewing the steps from before, we're going to bring the constant term over to the right. So we're going to get x squared, and we're going to do this through subtraction, plus 10x equals negative 30. All right, now as way of review, remember that 2b in this case is equal to 10. That makes b equal to 5. And that makes b squared equal to 25. That's what we want to add in to both sides of the equation. So going down below, we're going to turn this into x squared plus 10x plus 25 equals negative 30 plus 25. All right, now we have a perfect square on the left. We can factor that as x plus 5 squared. And just remember, every time, if you're trying to figure out what this term should be down here, it's going to be your b. We saw that from the pattern before. All right, and on the right, we're going to have negative 30 plus 25, so that's negative 5. We now want to take the square root of both sides because we have that perfect square. So we're going to have x plus 5 is equal to plus or minus the square root of negative 5. So if you're in a class and you have not covered imaginary complex numbers, you might say, oh, there is no solution to this particular quadratic. But if you have covered complex numbers, then you'll know we can bring the negative 5 over, and we can rewrite this as plus or minus I root 5. And recall that I is equal to the square root of negative 1. That'll be a future video. Okay, so let's go ahead and do a second practice problem. Go ahead and pause the video now if you'd like to try it on your own. This time around, we're going to try to turn our equation into the vertex form of a parabola. That's what this equation is right here. A times x minus h squared plus k, where the vertex of a parabola would be h comma k, those coordinates. Down below we have a reminder of parabola is a U-shaped curve. It could face up or down. A will tell us that. And this point right here is called the vertex, And that's what h and k will give us. So if we can take our equation on the left here and make it look like this one up here on the right, we can easily find what the vertex would be. So let's go ahead and we'll do that again by completing the square. You'll notice we have a constant term or a leading coefficient of 4 this time. We're not going to divide through because we don't want to end up with a statement like y over 4. So what we're going to do is we're going to factor out that 4 to begin with. So we're going to turn this into x squared minus 8x. Now, I don't want to include the constant term. You'll see why in a minute. It's not going to be part of the perfect square I'm going to create. We're going to do our analysis like we did before. So again, 2b is going to be equal to 8. And b, therefore, is going to be half of 8, which is 4. And b squared is going to be 16. So what I want to do is I want to add a 16 in there, in those parentheses, to complete my square. So going back, we're going to write y equals 4 times x squared minus 8x plus 16. Now, and then I can write the negative 13. This equation is not the same as the one above. You can't just add that 16 in. I need to remove that. But it's not technically a 16 either, because of this 4 would eventually be multiplied by that 16. What I've really done is I've added in 64. 4 times 16 is 64. So to keep the equation the same, I now have to subtract 64. So again, because I'm doing something slightly different this time, I'm trying to get the form, the vertex form for a parabola, and I can't just divide that 4 out. When I'm trying to complete my square, I have to account for the 4 that I factored out when I add the 16 in. And that's why I'm subtracting now a 64. So I've essentially not added anything into the equation. So let's go ahead and clean this up. We're going to get 4 times x minus 4 squared. And again, if you do x minus 4 squared, you'll eventually, if you FOIL that, you'll get x squared minus 8x plus 16. And then we have a minus 77 when we combine the negative 13 and the negative 64. So what does that tell us? It tells us that my vertex is going to have coordinates 4, comma, negative 77. And that comes from our vertex form up above. Whatever our h is in this equation, which was a negative 4, but the h itself is actually a positive 4, is going to be our x-coordinate of the vertex. And then we do plus k, and remember that k is the y-coordinate of the vertex. In this case, we're subtracting negative 77, so that means k is negative 77. Okay, it's time for practice problem number 3. Go ahead and pause the video if you'd like to try this on your own. This time we are going to solve for the center of a circle. The last video was on this exact formula. And recall that our center will again be the points h, k if we can turn our equation into this form above, which we will do by using completing the square twice. All right? So to begin, let's take a look at our equation. We have x squared minus 2x, and then we have y squared plus 14y. So this time we're going to do completing the square twice. So here we're going to do x squared minus 2x. What will we add in this time? Let's take 2, divide it by 2, that's 1, square the result. We need to add in a 1. What about with y? So now we're going to have y squared plus 14y. Now our 2b is 14, so b would be 7. If we squared that, that's 49, so we need to add a 49 here. I'm going to go ahead and bring that negative 10 over to the right through addition. And we have to keep the equation balanced. We added a 1 for our x terms, and we added in a 49 for our y terms. Going back over here, we can turn this into our perfect square. X minus 1 squared plus our second perfect square, y plus 7 squared equals 60. And by the way, the constant on the right in our equation above is equal to the radius squared. So we know that the radius would be the square root of 60 at this point. But in this case, we were solving just for the center of our circle, which is going to be the point 1, comma, negative 7. And those coordinates came from our B here, which was, remember the form is x minus h, so that's why it's 1. And then it's y minus k, so even though there's an addition sign here, we want to have a negative 7 for our y coordinate. Okay, bottom line, what did we learn today? Completing the square is a technique we can use to rewrite quadratic expressions and then take the square root of both sides if we need to. We can use it to solve quadratic equations, but we can also use it to find alternative forms of equations, which is helpful in the cases of conic shapes such as parabolas, circles, ellipses, and hyperbolas. That's all I got for today, but before I let you go...
All right, Buttercup.
Let's tell the folks how they can help grow the channel. Please like, subscribe, comment about future content you'd like to see and how I can improve these videos, tell your classmates, and consider joining the flock on Patreon for extra practice problems and videos with tips for taking standardized tests. Please see the description below for details.